Welcome to Fashion History Part 1, The Evolution of Clothing. In this video, we will look at fashion from prehistory up until the first century of the Common Era. Early humans lived as hunter-gatherers. Living in small groups, they followed animals as they migrated for food. Archaeologists believe that humans began to wear clothing 170,000 years ago. This allowed people to migrate out of Africa and into colder climates. They figured this out by studying lice. For more information about how archaeologists came to this conclusion, I've linked the articles below. In fact, I've linked all the articles below. Protection from the elements seems to be a pretty obvious reason to invent clothing, but what if there's more to the story? In the warmer climates of the tropics, tattoos are a popular form of body decoration. Many of these tattoos have significance within the culture, from rites of passage, group membership, marital status, and even possibly pain management. Some of the earliest evidence that we have for tattooed humans was found on the body of Uzi, the Iceman found on the Italian and Austrian border. He dates from about 5,200 years ago. We also have tattooed female mummies in Egypt from about 4,000 years ago. There are also mummies from Peru with tattoos. So maybe the idea of clothing began with tattoos. In her book, Women's Work, The First 20,000 Years, Elizabeth Wayland Barber postulates that decoration to attract the opposite sex may have been the catalyst for the development of clothing. She points to the Venus statues with their string aprons found throughout Europe. The oldest of these statues has been dated from 35 to 40,000 years. These string aprons were clearly not worn as protection, but more likely worn as an enticement. Look here, swish, swish. Meanwhile, anthropologists have long studied the Kung Bushmen, or sand people, of the Kalahari Desert in South Africa as a potential lens into the past. This group have lived there for thousands of years, and recent DNA evidence shows that they may be the source of all Homo sapiens. Their clothing consists of animal hides, which cover only their waist, resembling a modern-day thong, which appears largely functional. Footwear developed around 25,000 years ago, beginning as leather or plant fiber-based sandals, serving to protect the feet from hot ground in the desert, or furry boots tied to the ankles for icy conditions in snowy regions. The fact is, we're still learning about the origins of clothing and fashion. There is also a correlation between clothing and the cooling trends of the last ice age, which began around 100,000 years ago and ended between 11 and 12,000 years ago. Clearly, colder weather means a need for warmer clothing. The earliest indication of thread is some flax fibers found in a cave in the Republic of Georgia, dating from around 34,000 years ago. This could have been used to sew hides together or even make early linen fabric. Once the Ice Age ended around 11,000 years ago, people tired of the nomadic existence and started settling down into horticultural societies. Women started tending small gardens and children, while men still went off on hunting and fishing expeditions nearby. Having a permanent house meant that they could start collecting more stuff, including clothes. Even though Uzi is only around 5,000 years old, most anthropologists conclude that his style of clothing may date back to the Ice Age or before. And we know quite a bit about what Uzi was wearing because much of his clothing was preserved in the ice. He had clothing made from the leather of five different animals: a sheep hide loincloth, goat leather leggings. Notice that they're not connected at the waist, but tied separately onto a belt. That's why pants are called a pair, even though they're now one article of clothing. Footwear with cowhide lacing, a brown bear fur hat, a belt to hold tools, such as a knife or pouch, including a quiver from deer hide, a coat patched crudely together from goat and sheep hides, And he also had a cloak made of grass, which may have doubled as his bedding on the road. By this time, wealth begins to be reflected in clothing. People add more accessories, jewelry, and other adornments to show off social class and style. People now must build walls around their communities to protect themselves from thieves. The first large loom weaving is invented around 6000 BC. Made from flax, wool, hemp, nettle, and cotton, fabric was quite valuable. Eventually, humans began domesticating animals, and farming turned from small gardens to larger agricultural endeavors, and men took over the farm, using plows and oxen, which required more physical strength and did not mix well with looking after toddlers. This led to larger towns and cities, separation of labor, and more fashion opportunities. Since sheep were now domesticated, wool became more readily available, because up until that point, people had to collect wool from bushes that sheep had walked through and shed on. Mesopotamia! Mesopotamia is often called the cradle of civilization. Located in what is now Iraq, both men and women wore wraparound skirts made of sheepskin with the fur on the outside combed into decorative tufts. A sheepskin cape could be worn around the shoulders. In their society, the longer the skirt, the higher the social rank. By 2700 BCE, woven wool had replaced the sheepskins, but the decorative tufts remained. They also wore long cloaks and fez-like hats made of felted wool or leather. Both sexes wore large wigs, adding elaborate metal headdresses and beautiful jewelry. Fashion changed slowly back in the day, and it wasn't until 400 years later that a wool garment similar to a shawl with tassels came into fashion. The Babylonians and Assyrians. The Babylonians and Assyrians created a more sophisticated version of earlier styles, including a tunic, and the t-shirt was invented. They wore long tunics with short sleeves and a belt to hold it all together. The tassel shawl was still popular, and the entire ensemble was brightly colored and highly decorated. Hair was long and curled. Men even grew their beards long and curled them in elaborate ways. Bronze Age Judea! Hebrews typically wore linen and sometimes wool. They wore brightly colored tunics, robes belted with sashes, and turbans on their heads. The Levitical law that wins the prize for weird is Deuteronomy 22:11.
Do not wear clothes of wool and linen woven together.
Why on earth did God make such an odd prohibition? In its ancient context, though, the law had a perfectly logical reasoning. Both the priestly garments and the tabernacle weavings were a combination of wool and linen. The priest's white undergarment was linen, and the colorful vestment was wool. So it was prohibited for laypersons to dress in the same way. Egypt. Walk like an Egyptian. Egyptians were very fastidious about their appearance, wearing linen tunics, loincloths, kilts, and gossamer thin wraps. They had elaborate hairstyles and often wore wigs. Both men and women wore makeup, a trend that may have started with the dark kohl under their eyes to help prevent the glare of the desert sands, in much the same way football players today wear the black under their eye. Women would wear cones of beeswax on their head, probably as a kind of ritual headgear. Greece. The Greeks would take a single piece of fabric and restyle it in various ways to achieve a variety of looks. They wore wool or imported linen, which was cooler, but expensive. They often wore two rectangles of fabric pinned at the shoulders and belted at the waist. This garment for men is known as a chiton. The ladies' version was the same, except longer and called a peplos. If wool, it would be dyed bright colors. But as linen does not dye well, they would have to embroider it or paint it with elaborate designs. Greeks went barefoot a lot, and when they wore shoes, it was thin sandals or boots. In cold weather, a cloak called a hemation was draped over the shoulders and resembled a toga. And speaking of togas, let's see what the Romans were getting up to. The Romans really liked to follow Greek fashion, so they too wore a chiton. Only Roman citizens were allowed to wear the famous toga. Clothes telegraphed what social class you belonged to. If you had a thin red stripe on your tunic, for example, it disclosed that you owned horses. A broad red stripe showed that you were a senator. Otherwise, togas were always white, often bleached with stale urine to keep it a snowy color. These garments were, of course, only for men. Women wore Greek-style peplos, but once married, would wear a long-draped garment called a stola. The only women who wore togas were prostitutes. Hair was curled and styled with combs, gold hairnets, and coils of braids. Wealthy women were expected to spend a long time getting their hair done. Celtic, Norse, and Germanic. Moving into Northern Europe now, the Celts also wore tunics, but their fashion was more layered and warmer since they lived in a colder climate. They would wear long T-shaped tunics. For both men and women, the sleeves narrow at the wrist, and bracelets or bracers were worn on top of the sleeves. The overtunic, which looks very similar to a Greek chiton, is referred to as a bog dress, since most that have survived were found in peat bogs where the acid levels of the mud preserved the fabric. Wool was the most used fiber, along with fur. Linen was also used, and when it was, they embroidered it beautifully, sometimes with actual gold. Their jewelry was gorgeous and beautifully crafted. The torque, not this one, is the most famous and was used as a symbol of high rank. In battle, men wore ringmail shirts and spiked their hair up with lime. This created a fearsome effect and bleached their hair at the same time. The Celts in Northern Britain would wear a hallucinogenic blue dye called woad to complete their terrifying look. This 1,700-year-old sweater was recently found in a melting glacier in Norway that shows clothing was lovingly taken care of and patched when damaged. Viking women wore their wealth in the form of lovely brooches and beads on the front of their dresses. Viking men wore trousers, knee-length belted tunics, and a simple rectangular cape. The famous horned helmet of the Vikings was extremely rare. Their helmets looked more like this. We're now gonna take a quick trip to Asia to see what folks there were wearing. In ancient China, the poor wore clothing of hemp or rami, while the wealthy wore, you guessed it, silk. The Chinese had lots of rules regarding social class and clothing. During the Su dynasty, for example, only the emperor was allowed to wear yellow, while the poor, they had to wear black or blue. White was worn for mourning and still is to this day. Well, red is the color of brides and symbolizes happiness and joy. During the Yuan dynasty, cotton was introduced by the invading Mongol horde. How many hordes could a Mongol horde if Mongol horde got bored? At this time, women wore long tunics with full sleeves, while men wore knee-length tunics and trousers. Both wore robes over the top that were belted with wide sashes. Clothing for the wealthy was fantastically embroidered with brightly colored silk threads. The most popular style, the hanfu, was a knee-length tunic tied with a sash. A pleated underskirt completes the look. This style is having a revival in China today. India! Indian people mostly wore cotton. In fact, India was the first place cotton was grown as early as 5000 BC. Men wore the dhoti, which is a cloth worn around the waist and knotted in the back. Some men wore turbans, while others invented the man bun. Their faces were clean shaven or they wore short beards. Indian women wore knee-length skirts and a cloth head wrap. They adorned themselves with shell bead bracelets and necklaces. By the Vedic period, women wore dresses like the Greek chiton. It really got around. While some women wore pleated skirts wrapped around their waist and tied in front, with a separate shawl or veil and a tight undershirt. By the Gupta period, around 500 AD, the sari was invented. The word sari is the Sanskrit word for cloth. Wealthy women wore silk saris imported from China. Ancient people traveled a surprising amount, and fabric was a source of wealth and value. You'll notice a lot of these clothing styles were simply made of rectangles. That's because fabric was so dear that you didn't want to waste any of it, so cut and fit came later. And that wraps it up for this episode of Fashion History. Please subscribe for more interesting content and ring the bell to be notified of new videos.